Well, good morning, everybody. Hey, if you guys would please open a copy of the Bibles that you have. If you don't have one, there's one under the seat right around you. You're going to need a Bible. I don't have the fancy screen that Jeff has, so you're going to definitely have, we're going to have to go old school here, right? We're going to have to pull out the paper copy, or on your phone, I suppose, as well. Open your Bibles to Acts chapter 9, verse 32. Last week, we left off in Acts chapter 9, verse 31. I'd like to read that passage to you as you turn to Acts 9. It says, "So the church throughout all Judea and Galilee and Samaria had peace and was being built up and walking in the fear of the Lord and in the comfort of the Holy Spirit, it multiplied." The kingdom of God is doing what the kingdom of God is supposed to be doing. It's expanding. Jesus told his apostles in Acts chapter 1, verse 8, "You will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses from Jerusalem to Judea to Samaria and to the ends of the earth." We're here this morning, and we're part of the ends of the earth, aren't we? The gospel is spread. The kingdom of God has broken in, and the kingdom of God is always going to do what the kingdom of God is supposed to do. Amen? If you're a parent, you probably remember the book, What to Expect When You're Expecting. Yep, I thought so. Even if you're not a parent, you've probably heard of this book before. The whole purpose of this book is to prepare women to let them know what to expect when they're expecting. The baby's already here, right? But what should we expect while we go through this stage of giving birth to the baby? How should you care for your body? What type of foods should you eat? What's harmful? Why am I suffering through this thing called morning sickness? Why am I going through this? Imagine if you didn't have the book, right? Imagine if you didn't know. You'd think there's something wrong. Why is my appetite changing? I remember Lori, she had this crazy appetite for asparagus. And then on another occasion, I think it was Frosted Flakes, right? And I just remember one time we were sitting at McDonald's, and she basically, this is like right before Isaac was about to be born, she reached across the table, she grabbed my fries, she pulled them over, and she just ate all my fries. And just like, not even like, thank you or anything, she just grabbed them, and I wasn't about to say anything. So you have these different appetites, right? I remember when she'd be sitting on the bed and her belly, and you'd see the head moving, and she was like, "Oh, look how cute, Brian, put your hand," and I was like, "Okay." It's like, it's kind of weird, but all right. Is there an alien in there, right? There's all these different changes that you go through when you're pregnant. And so the book is intended to help you to understand what to expect when you're expecting, what to expect while the baby's here in the womb, what to expect when the baby comes. Well, I think that the books of Luke and Acts, remember Luke wrote both Luke and Acts, I think that's kind of what those books are about. What should we expect when God's kingdom comes? What will it look like? Right? In the book of Luke, we see the King Jesus coming in a manger, and we see him growing, and we see him in Luke chapter 4 declaring himself to be the king, reading the prophecy of Isaiah, and he says, "This prophecy is fulfilled in your hearing." And then later on in Luke chapter 11, we see him casting out demons. And what do the people say? They say, "Oh, clearly you're doing this by sorcery. Clearly you're doing this by witchcraft." And Jesus is like, "What are you talking about? Satan's not going to cast out Satan. But if I, by the finger of God, cast out demons, the kingdom of God has come." And then into the book of Acts, he ascends and he goes and he sits at the right hand of God where he rules and reigns. And so he's a king now and he's ruling and reigning, but not yet, not fully. And the disciples said, "Okay, where's your kingdom? When are you going to bring your kingdom, Jesus?" And Jesus said, "It's not for you to know the times and seasons when my kingdom comes, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses from Jerusalem to Judea to Samaria to the ends of the earth." And that's where we're at right now, guys. We're in that phase, this strange season of life in which we see the kingdom of God growing, but we also see some strange things. We see sickness. We see death. We see Satan still working because God's kingdom has come, and yet it's still to come. It's already and yet not yet, right? I think that's what this passage is about. I think this passage, what we're about to read, is we're about to see Jesus trampling over the head of Satan through Peter. He did it in the book of Acts. He's doing it now. I'm sorry, he did it in the book of Luke, Jesus himself, and now he's doing it through the apostles. He's dancing on top of Satan's head in this passage. I want you to see that as we read this. Let's look. Acts chapter 9, verse 32. Now as Peter went here and there among them all, he came down also to the saints who lived at Lydda. And there he found a man named Aeneas, bedridden for 8 years, who was paralyzed. And Peter said to him, Aeneas, Jesus Christ heals you. Rise and make your bed. And immediately he rose. And all the residents of Lydda and Sharon saw him, and they turned to the Lord. Now there was in Joppa a disciple named Tabitha, which translated means Dorcas. She was full of good works and acts of charity. In those days she became ill and died. And when they had washed her, they laid her in an upper room. Since Lydda was near Joppa, the disciples, hearing that Peter was there, sent two men to him, urging him, please come to us without delay. So Peter rose and went with them. When he arrived, they took him to the upper room. All the widows stood beside him weeping and showing tunics and other garments that Dorcas made while she was with them. But Peter put them all outside and knelt down and prayed. And turning to the body, he said, Tabitha, arise. And she opened her eyes, and when she saw Peter, she sat up. And he gave her his hand and raised her up. Then calling the saints and widows, he presented her alive. And it became known throughout all Joppa, and many believed in the Lord. And he stayed in Joppa for many days with one Simon the Tanner. Do you see the previews of coming attractions? Do you see how Jesus is conquering sin and illness and death? He has conquered, and one day he's going to fully conquer. And so what we see in the book of Acts is we see previews of coming attractions. We see foretastes of his kingdom in all its fullness. During World War II, the war was effectively over on what? D-Day, right? The U.S. stormed the beaches of Normandy, and the victory was so strategic, it's so effective, that the war was essentially over, but not yet, not fully. There were still battles to fight. There were still wars to fight. Hitler would not go down without a fight, even though he had already lost. There was no way he was going to win at that point. That's kind of like Satan. Satan wants to steal and kill and destroy. That's his aim in your life right now. And we shouldn't be surprised when we see his handiwork all around us. We should expect to see, during this kingdom age, to see sickness, but we're also going to see healing. We should expect to see death, but we're also going to see resurrection. Amen? And so I want to elevate the work of Christ over Satan this morning. That's what this passage is about. Why did Luke write this passage? Why did the Holy Spirit inspire for us to see this? I think he wants us to see, do you see what my king has done? Do you see what Jesus has done? Do you see how he's conquered Satan? Do you see how Satan has no power over him? Do you see how Jesus in a moment can completely obliterate the work of Satan? Do you see that? Do you see the work of the king? I think that's what this passage is trying to tell us. There's this unmentioned foe in this passage. It's the devil. You don't see him by name, but you see his handiwork. And so I want to elevate Christ over Satan because Christ is victor over Satan. The kingdom of God has come, not fully, not yet, but the power of the kingdom is here with us. We're going to look at four different vantage points. There's four different vantage points in this passage. There's the vantage point of Aeneas. There's the vantage point of Dorcas. There's the vantage point of Peter. And there's the vantage point of the residents and the saints and Lydda and Sharon and Joppa. But before we do that, first I want to look at some kingdom passages. Where are we going? Where are we heading? When you're expecting a baby, you want to know what's this baby going to look like when it comes out, right? And so let's look at what the kingdom is going to look like in its fullness. Let's look at Isaiah chapter 35. Listen to these words. We're going to look at four passages. Listen how King Jesus tramples over the work of Satan with finality in these passages. It says, then the eyes of the blind shall be opened and the ears of the deaf unstopped. Then shall the lame man leap like a deer, and the tongue of the mute sing for joy. For waters break forth in the wilderness and streams in the desert, and the ransomed of the Lord shall return and come to Zion with singing. Everlasting joy shall be upon their heads. They shall obtain gladness and joy. Sorrow and sighing shall flee away. Let's look at Isaiah chapter 11, verse 9. They shall not hurt or destroy in all my holy mountain, for the earth shall be full of the knowledge of the Lord. Can you imagine a day when the knowledge of the Lord completely fills the earth? No more ignorance of him. No more ignorance of who the real king is. Whew, amen. Daniel chapter 12, and many of those who sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life and some to everlasting contempt. Sadly, Satan is going to take some of us with him. Will he take you with him? Some of us will raise to everlasting life. That is, those who will put their faith in Jesus Christ, those who are made righteous through the blood of the King, Jesus, who conquered sin and who conquered death by dying on the cross and rising again. There's going to be a resurrection. We're going to be with the King forever and ever. Everlasting life. Let's look at this passage. If you ever want to read a passage when you're down and depressed, this is the one to go to. Revelation 21, last passage. Behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people. And God himself will be with them as their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. And death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore, for the former things have passed away. Do you see how Jesus has trampled over the work of Satan? In the kingdom age, there's going to be no more sorrow. There's going to be no more sighing. It's going to flee away. The lame will leap like a deer. Those who are blind will see. Those who are deaf will hear. The people that can't speak, they're going to sing. There's going to be not just joy, everlasting joy. And God's going to be with us. God is going to be with us forever and ever and ever. This is the hope that we have in King Jesus, but not yet. Not yet. We're not there yet. We're still in a battle. We're still in a war. Satan, our adversary, is still wanting to pull us away. Let's look at the four vantage points. Number one, Aeneas. When you're expecting God's kingdom, expect sickness and expect healing. Verse 32, now as Peter went here and there among them all, he came down also to the saints who lived at Lydda. There he found a man named Aeneas, bedridden for 8 years, who was paralyzed. And Peter said to him, Aeneas, Jesus Christ heals you. Rise and make your bed. Jesus demonstrating his power over Satan in the work of Aeneas. We don't know a lot about Aeneas, but we do know this. At one point, he could walk. It says that he was sick. He was paralyzed for 8 years. 8 years. 8 years. Think about that. I think sometimes we cross over these kinds of passages without really thinking about that. 8 years. Do you know how long that is? I did the math. It's 70,000 plus hours. Can you imagine sitting on the floor, just sitting on the floor for 70,000 hours? Can you think of a time when you were sick and you had to sit in the same place for 5 hours or maybe 3 days? What does that feel like? 70,000 hours. Satan, this is the work of the devil. All the kind of hopelessness he wants to sow in the lives of people. The hopelessness this man must have felt, unable to care for himself, unable to work, unable to walk, unable to dance, unable to climb. unable to have children. You know, when it rains, what do you do when it rains? You go, oh, it's raining, and you step out from under it, and you go, you know, right? Rain would be a massive undertaking for this man. 70,000 hours he's stuck there. Think about that. And we see people like this all the time around us. And they're sick, and they're hopeless. And we don't know what he felt, but maybe he knew Isaiah 35. And maybe he knew that in God's kingdom, the lame will leap like a deer. But when he read those, when he would read those words, maybe it just like made him bitter and upset. Like, God, I don't see this happening in my life. Maybe he doubted God. We don't know. For sure, he had to feel hopeless. Satan wants to spread hopelessness. He loves to do that. He wants to spread hopelessness. And during this period of history, while we're waiting, we should expect seasons of hopelessness. We can expect to be very dependent on others at times. We're unable to do the things we want to do. We're paralyzed. Maybe you're paralyzed in another way. Maybe you're paralyzed in a relationship. It just doesn't seem like it's ever going to come to life again. Maybe you are paralyzed by some kind of sickness and you just think, is this ever going to go away? Maybe you're paralyzed by what Satan has done in the life of somebody else. Sometimes that can be even harder, right? Because you can't control how that person reacts to it. You can control how you react, but you can't control how that person reacts. Maybe you're paralyzed by a prodigal son or a prodigal daughter, and you just think this person's never coming back. Oh, how Satan loves that, and how Jesus has conquered the work of Satan. This is what we should expect when you're in the middle of a war. We should expect paralyzing situations, but we should also expect to see times of healing. Notice that when he was healed, it says in verse 34 that immediately he rose. When God does a miracle, it's immediate. It just happens. He went from 70,000 hours. I mean, think about this. This really happened, right? 70,000 hours he's sitting there to immediately standing up. I mean, have you ever sat for 3 hours, 4 hours, and you stand up and your legs are tingly and you're kind of like, whoa. Jesus gave him everything he needed at that moment. And Jesus can give you everything you need in the moment of your suffering and your struggle. That's the message. Satan loves to sow hopelessness into the lives of God's people, and Jesus loves to overcome hopelessness. He triumphs over it. He tramples the head of Satan. He dances on Satan's head by overcoming hopelessness in the lives of God's people. This is what he does. Jesus, through Peter, is flexing his muscles over Satan. God can give you everything you need to rise in the midst of your situation. But this is what we should expect. This is what we should expect to see when we're expecting God's kingdom. For some of us, we will be paralyzed all of our lives. But we can know that God will heal one day in the kingdom. The passages we just read, he will heal one day. Maybe this entire life you're going to go through this paralyzing situation, but God will heal one day. Now, I want to read to you a passage in Romans chapter 8, but before I do that, I want to talk about Satan's tool shed. Satan has a tool shed, by the way. I don't know if you knew that or not. He's got this tool shed, and he's got all of his tools laid out, and this man comes to his tool shed, and he's looking at these tools, and he's like, okay, here's the tool of lust. Here's the tool of doubt. He's looking at all these different tools. He looks down at the end, and there's this tool that's really well-worn. It's kind of odd-looking. It's odd-shaped, but it's like really beat up. And he says, Satan, what's this tool? And Satan says, oh, I love this tool. This is my favorite tool. I love this tool because I can use this tool and God's people don't even know that I'm using it. This is my favorite tool. It's a tool of discouragement. Satan loves to discourage. He loves to tell you that it's not going to be over. He loves to tell you there is no hope. He loves to tell you that God can't heal, but God can heal. God will heal. Amen. Listen to this passage, Romans chapter 8, verse 17. And if children, then heirs. So he's been talking about the fact that we are the children of God in verse 16. And he says, if we're children, then we're heirs. Heirs of God and fellow heirs with Christ. What's he talking about? He's talking about the kingdom, that we are going to inherit the kingdom with Christ. But then he says this. He says, we're heirs of God and we're fellow heirs with Christ, provided, there's a condition, provided we suffer with him in order that we may also be glorified. We will inherit a kingdom of God provided that we suffer, or we can't expect to receive the inheritance. While we wait for the inheritance, we must suffer. And every one of us is allotted to a different amount of suffering in life. But if we suffer with him, we are guaranteed that we will receive this inheritance with him. In other words, it's part of being in God's kingdom. You're going to suffer. We're going to suffer, and we must suffer. We're going to groan. We're going to groan. But will we groan well? You know, in that same passage, he says that we groan within ourselves and that we hope and that we wait. This is what we do. This is what we should expect when we're expecting God's kingdom. Groaning, waiting, hoping. And if we do that well with him, we can be guaranteed that we will receive the inheritance. Jesus so often takes what Satan means for evil and uses it for good. How does he use suffering for good? Well, one of the ways he uses suffering for good is that when you groan well, when you suffer well, and when you recognize that this is a part of what I do with Christ, and when you do that well, it's a guarantee that you will receive this inheritance with Christ. It's an affirming, confirming thing, right? When you go through tough times and you go through these times with Jesus and you come out on the other side, you realize, wow, my faith is real. It's genuine. It's kind of like waiting in line. You go to the amusement park, what do you do? What does it look like? What do you expect when you go to the amusement park? You have to wait in line, right? You're not going to get on the line, on the ride unless you wait in the line. And so going to an amusement park looks like getting into a line. You groan, you wait, you suffer. They've got those little misters that kind of put a little bit, and you're like, you know. And you get little previews of coming attractions while you're in the line, and you're waiting and you're groaning. But if you get out of the line, you will not get on the ride. And that's exactly what Paul is saying. He's saying that we will inherit this glory with Christ, provided that we suffer with him. Let's look at point number two. Let's look at Dorcas's vantage point. Verse 36 through 37. Now there was in Joppa a disciple named Tabitha, which translated means Dorcas. She was full of good works and acts of charity. In those days she became ill and died. And when they had washed her, they laid her in an upper room. When you're expecting God's kingdom, expect death and expect resurrection. And here is a woman who was faithfully serving the body of Christ. She's full of good works and acts of charity. She's faithful. She's useful to the church. And then she becomes ill. What plans did she have that were ruined? And it's very possible that she was serving the widows that were here, because they're showing the tunics and the garments that she made. She was most likely ministering to these women. And they're there, and they're showing these tunics and these garments. She's useful. It's a good person. And this happens. She gets ill and she dies. How does this happen in God's kingdom? Hasn't Jesus conquered death? Why would he allow this to happen? We should expect death and expect resurrection. All that she had to do was put on hold. Perhaps she was tempted to feel like God let her down. Maybe she's tempted to be angry with God. That's exactly what Satan wants, isn't it? We really don't know what she felt. But one thing we know for sure, the text doesn't tell us, but we know that she was surprised by this illness, right? When illness comes, we're surprised. We always are. We don't expect it. We don't know. And death is hanging over our heads like a guillotine, right? And we know it's going to come. We know not when, but we know it's going to happen. But Jesus has trampled over death, and he's turned that guillotine into a doorway to where now we rejoice. Even in the midst of death, in this strange way, it's so hard and it's so painful, and yet we rejoice in it because we see that this guillotine has been turned into a doorway. It's an entrance into the kingdom of God. I got a friend named Curtis Whitmore. And I saw Curtis Whitmore, this faithful brother, loved the Lord, got cancer. And it spread and it got worse and it got worse. And he ended up hospitalized. But I'll tell you something about Curtis. Man, Curtis was this, he was this big burly guy. He was a construction worker. He had this deep voice like this. And he would always call me and he'd be like, brother, we got to pray about that. Let's pray about that, brother. And he had this hat that he wore. It said, Jesus is my rock. You know, one of those guys. Just this guy, just full of faith. And he, everywhere he'd go, he would share Christ with everybody. He was definitely an evangelist. He had that gift. And I would visit him in the hospital, and there's Curtis lying in the bed, and he's like, brother, I'm working on these nurses, but man, they are just, they won't listen to me. I'm trying to tell, you know, he's not thinking about himself. He's thinking about sharing his faith with the nurses. I'm like, Curtis, you're dying, and all you can think about is getting these nurses and this doctor saved. That's how God tramples over death. You don't feel the effects of it the same way. Death has lost its sting. Recently, we lost a brother in our congregation, Gordon Carlson. And I didn't get to know Gordon myself personally. I wish I would have, because I got to hear about his life. Gordon, it sounds to me, was just this amazing brother. 92 years old. Do you know what Gordon was doing up to the point of his death? He was sharing his faith in the home that he was a part of. He was teaching through the book of John. He was teaching through the book of John. Faithfully serving God, 92 years old. God, may you help me to serve you in that way when I'm 92 years old. He dies, or he goes to sleep. He wakes up, and he's in the presence of Jesus. Oh, man, that's how I want to go. I want to go to sleep and wake up, and I'm in the presence of God. I mean, talk about trampling over the head of Satan. Gordon completely trampled over the head of Satan in his life, didn't he? Death did not have power over him. He went to sleep, he woke up, and he's in the presence of Jesus. Can you imagine what that would be like? And I guarantee at his funeral, people, I mean, of course, people are sad, they miss him, but it's no longer he's gone. He's not gone. And we're going to see him again. I get to meet him one day. I can't wait. He's not gone. Death no longer has its sting. Death no longer has power over us. Satan's greatest tool, death, has been conquered by Jesus. Listen to this verse. Hebrews chapter 2, verse 14. Since therefore the children share in flesh and blood, he himself likewise partook of the same things, that through death he might destroy the one who has the power of death, that is the devil, and deliver all those who through fear of death were subject to lifelong slavery. Jesus destroyed death through his own death and resurrection. He destroyed the one who has the power over death, Satan. Death has been conquered, yet not fully, not finally. It's already destroyed, but not yet fully destroyed. And so we should still expect to see death, but we should also expect to see resurrection. Dorcas in this passage is resurrected from the dead. I mean, what do you think she said to Peter after? What are you doing? Right? You know, I was just having the conversation with Jesus. You interrupted us. You know, she's brought back to life. I don't know. But what are we seeing in this passage, though? We're seeing that Jesus is flexing his muscles over one of our greatest enemies, one of the things that strikes the most fear into our hearts, death. Jesus is flexing his muscles over it. It has no power over me, right? It has no power over you. It had no power over Gordon. It had no power over Curtis. Death has lost its sting. Doesn't mean it's not hard, but it's not a guillotine anymore. It's a doorway. It's a doorway into the presence of God. Third vantage point, let's look at Peter. When you're expecting God's kingdom, expect to see needs and expect to be used. Expect to see needs. In verse 32, we read, now as Peter went here and there among them all. He's talking about the church. And so Peter here is going about and he's strengthening and he's establishing and he's teaching these churches how to do war, how to prepare, how to become better citizens of God's kingdom. That's what he's doing. We're going to see Paul do the same thing when we get to Paul's second missionary journey. He's going to return and he's going to strengthen the churches there. But he's just going about doing God's work. He's just going about doing God's work because that's what we're supposed to do when we're waiting for God's kingdom. He comes to Lydda, and he finds a man named Aeneas. Peter stops what he's doing. Note that. He speaks to him. He engages with this man. This isn't exactly why he's here, and yet it's exactly why he's here. He stops his plans. He engages with this man, and then he speaks these powerful words, "Jesus Christ heals you." We don't always know how to meet the needs of others around us. We see people like this all around us. But one thing we can always do is we can always speak the name of Jesus into somebody's life. You know, just speak the name of Jesus. If you don't know what to say, if you don't know what to do, just do something. Speak the name of Jesus. You know, and we can't meet all the needs around us. And we don't know what it was that caused Peter to know that God was going to do this work. We have no idea. But the one thing I do know is I know when God is tugging on my heart and telling me to talk to somebody, go talk to that person. Sadly, I don't always listen. Sometimes it's because I don't know what to say. I don't know what to do. But the one thing I can always do is I can always tell that person about Jesus. I can always go and speak the name of Jesus in that person's life. When you don't know what to do, speak the name of Jesus. Peter's mission was to go to the saints in Lydda, but his plans are interrupted when he finds Aeneas. Expect to have your plans interrupted. We should expect to see needs, but when we see them, we need to do something about it, don't we? If we tell ourselves, "I'm too busy," we're never going to meet the needs that are around us. We're always going to be busy, you guys. I hear that all the time. "I'm too busy." We're always going to be busy. When are you going to not be busy? You're always going to be busy. And if you say, "I'm too busy," you're never going to do it, right? We're always going to be busy. There's always needs around us. And if we want to serve God, we're going to have our plans interrupted at times. But we're also going to see God work in powerful ways when we allow our plans to be interrupted. Peter allows his plans to be interrupted, and this man is healed. After this, Peter is brought to Joppa by the disciples again. Again, his schedule is very flexible. He's pulled aside. Now, I want you to see something that's pretty interesting in this passage. In verses 38 through 41, what is Luke doing here? He gives us this picture of Peter that's almost identical to a picture of Jesus in Luke chapter 8. You can read that later on, but I want to just walk you through this. Look at verse 38. In Luke chapter 8, Jesus goes to Jairus' daughter, if you remember. And the things that happen with Jesus are almost identical to what happens with Peter. So what's Peter doing? He's walking in the footsteps of Jesus. He's mimicking what he witnessed Jesus do. He says, "Okay, I'm in this situation. I'm going to do what Jesus did." Look at verse 38. "Since Lydda was near Joppa, the disciples, hearing that Peter was there, sent two men to him, urging him, 'Please come to us without delay.'" In Luke chapter 8, Jesus was urged to come. In Acts chapter 9, Peter is urged to come. Verse 39, "So Peter rose and went with them." They both go. "And when he arrived, they took him to the upper room." There's an upper room in both stories. "All the widows stood beside him, weeping and showing him tunics and other garments that Dorcas made while she was with them." There's weeping and there's mourning in Luke chapter 8 as well. "But Peter put them all outside," just like Jesus did. "And he knelt down and prayed, and turning to the body, he said, 'Tabitha, arise.' And she opened her eyes, and when she saw Peter, she sat up, and he gave her his hand," just like Jesus does, "and raises her up. Then calling the saints and the widows, he presented her alive," just like Jesus did." I mean, Peter is following in the footsteps of Jesus. Pretty amazing. And so can we. We can walk in the footsteps of Jesus. And when we're faced with a situation, you guys know I'm about to say it, don't you? What would Jesus do? It's true. What would Jesus do? Or what would Jesus have me to do? What would Jesus think? What would Jesus say? What would the word say to me to do in this situation? Right? We can walk in the footsteps of Jesus. A lot of people make fun of that, WWJD. There's truth to it, though. Sometimes we just need to ask, what would Jesus do? What would he have me to do? And we need to do that. Peter is walking in the footsteps of the king here. All right, last vantage point. We're going to look at the saints in Lydda, the residents of Lydda and Sharon, and the disciples, the widows. When you're expecting God's kingdom, expect to witness suffering. and expect to be amazed. Expect to witness suffering. We're going to witness suffering in this world. We're going to see our loved ones taken. We should expect that to happen. But when you witness so much suffering in this world, how you handle that makes all the difference, doesn't it? Doesn't it? I mean, three things we can know for sure. God is in total control. God is good, and there is suffering. That presents a problem for a lot of people. And there's ways to not handle this problem. One way to not handle it is to say that God is the author of sin. God is not the author of sin. It's Satan that brought sin and sickness and death into this world. Another way that's wrong is to say that God is indifferent to it. Some kind of a deist God. He doesn't care about the suffering in this world. That's not true either. We know that because he sent his son into the world to die and to pay for sin and sickness and death. God cares very much about the sin and the sickness in this world, and he's going to do something about it, and he has done something about it. But we're in this strange phase of history in which he's not yet fully ruling and reigning. Another thing that we should not say is that God is not in control. He is in control. I don't know why God allows suffering to happen most of the time. I have no idea. Nobody can answer that question. That's where faith comes in. Amen? But here's the thing that I always tell myself. I always remind myself of this. And you guys will probably hear me say this a million times. Whenever I don't understand what God is doing, I always look to the cross. Because when you look at the cross, when you see the Son of God who was slain and killed in a shameful way, the most unjust, wicked thing that could ever happen. When you see that and you realize that through that, God brings about the greatest good, the greatest salvation, that helps me to remind, I remind myself, God can turn evil for good. He can. If he can do it with Jesus, he can do it with this circumstance. I don't fully understand why God allows suffering, neither do you. But when we look to the cross, we see the greatest injustice, the greatest suffering, the greatest scene of cruelty, and yet it causes the greatest salvation, the greatest peace, the greatest reconciliation, the greatest good, the greatest hope. So we're going to see suffering, but we can expect to be amazed. We should expect to see Jesus trampling the head of Satan in our lives. In verse 35, we read that all the residents of Lydda and Sherea saw him and they turned to the Lord. The whole region got saved. I believe this is actually speaking of a total revival in this area, because down in verse 42, it became known throughout all Joppa and many believed in the Lord. Different word. There was this massive revival that ensued, and it all started with a man who was bedridden for 8 years and a woman who died. But Jesus comes and he flexes his muscles through Peter, and people get saved. And that's what God is going to do in our lives. As Jesus flexes his muscles in our lives, as we see deliverance in our life, as we see healing, as we see him get us through paralyzing situations, people will see that and they'll want the kind of hope that we have in Jesus. And that's what we should expect when we're expecting God's kingdom. Amen? Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for this passage that we can now look at and we can remember and realize and once again just rejoice over the fact that you have conquered sin and sickness and death. You have triumphed over it. And we now have such great hope because of what you've done. God, I pray for the people that are here. Perhaps there are those who don't know you, Lord. Would you give them faith today? Would you rise them from the dead, Lord? Perhaps there are those who are going through hopeless situations, God. Would you meet their needs? Perhaps people feel paralyzed, God. Help them to see that maybe it won't go in this life, but one, there's a kingdom to come in which there will be no more sorrow or sighing, no more groaning. And God, while we wait for your kingdom to come, help us to groan well. Help us to suffer well. For your glory, Lord, in Jesus' name, amen.